I want to welcome you all to the sixth in our series on crossing borders. As many of you know, the first four looked at the challenges of leaving Mexico and coming to the United States. Our second four look at the diverse challenges and triumphs of building communities in the United States. I am going to remind, because I don't see the red light, we are recording. And this session will be recorded. And in about a week, it will join the others so that the whole series will be available for consultation in sequence or completely out of order, as you might wish, on the Americas Institute website. I will remind too that our presentation today will go on for about 40, 45 minutes. But as around that point, we're going to want to open the conversation to our wider community. And at that point, we want to remind you all, and we'll remind again, to open the Q&A function so that your questions will be typed in and we will present them as they have come in. It is my great pleasure. Again, the few of you who haven't already heard me before, I'm John Tutino. I'm a professor here at Georgetown, whose interests are Mexico, its communities in the context of a wider world. And it's a real pleasure today to not only welcome Mike Amezcua, but to, in addition, welcome Marcia Chatelain, who, as I have apologized endlessly to them, it was my own distraction that I didn't get to announce to all of you that Marcia was joining us for this conversation today. But I will quickly add, this becomes the double benefit. So I will first note, and Marcia is well known, that she is now full professor of history at Georgetown. She first, shortly after she came here, was the author of Southside Girls, an important study of growing up as young African-American women on the south side of Chicago, a study that Michelle Obama went out of her way to make important by getting her husband elected to the presidency. I don't know if she's demanded a share of your royalties for that achievement. I tease, it was a really important book and didn't need Michelle Obama to. But obviously the link to today's conversation has much to do with Marcia's having previously done pivotal work on African-American Chicago Southside women, and now Mike's work. But before I turn to Mike, I have to add that Marcia's recent, though I guess not quite so recent now, second book called Franchise on McDonald's in Black America has made her, I believe I can say, the first Georgetown faculty member to ever win a Pulitzer Prize, and more than earned for an amazing piece of work. And then I'm gonna say, with a little kudo to the Americas Forum for having discussed a chapter or two of that along the way. So welcome, Marcia. And the way we're going to operate today is a little bit different. So it's going to be a conversation. I'm going to do this introduction and then I'm going to back away and let Marcia and Mike have a conversation about Chicago and all its complexity. But I have to stop and then really take a moment and formally introduce Mike Amezcua, who is a little less well known simply because he's a more recent arrival at Georgetown. Mike got his BA from UCLA, and if I'm right, is originally from LA, which he then went on to get his PhD at Yale University and taught at NYU for a time before he joined us at Georgetown, right now 2 years ago, I think. Author of numerous articles, numerous op-ed pieces. He's a pretty active public intellectual. But what has really moved him to the head of I'll say his generation, is his recent book, Making Mexican Chicago, From Postwar Settlement to the Age of Gentrification. And it is a book that I want to say joins a small key core of Mexican-American urban studies. And to make it clear what distinguished company I think it enters, that he follows George Sanchez, who many of us heard last week. And if you were listening, George, pardon me for saying, but it took George two books to get to the contemporary post-war era. George has done wonderful work. The only other study I think carries parallel import is Robert Smith's Mexican New York, which in similar though different ways took on a deep look at the coming of Mexicans and the making of Mexican New York in the late 20th, early 21st century. But Mike now takes the lead in reminding us that if Mexican Americans often began in the fields in the United States, they very quickly and enduringly settled in our cities, have defined our cities, have reshaped our cities. And we are an increasingly urban society. So I want to say thank you to both Marcia and Mike. Welcome you both. And I will step back and let you folks take over the conversation.
Thank you so much, John, and welcome to everyone to this incredible conversation that I love having with my colleague, Mike Amezcua, because this book is really outstanding on so many different levels. But before I jump in with my million and a half questions, for those of you who are in graduate school right now, there's this very important moment where your advisor or one of your classmates will say, you know, what do you want your contribution to be? You know, and that's such a difficult thing to wrap your head around when you're first emerging as a scholar. And, you know, Mike, your book makes so many contributions, but let's start with in the conceptualization of this story. What did you feel like the field needed? And what are the contributions that you're proudest of when you think of this book?
Thank you so much, Marcia. Let me start off by just expressing my gratitude for being in dialogue with my two illustrious senior colleagues, John Tutino and Marcia Chatlin, and this platform, the Americas Forum, for this opportunity to explore some of the themes in the book. And of course, my gratitude to all the other participants of this series that Professor Tutino has put together. The names on that series alone are folks who have really helped me think about my own work. Of course, George Sanchez being one of those names, and a very influential group of scholars. And so I'm really appreciative of this platform. That's a really good question, Marcia, because I think that, when you're in grad school and you're thinking about your work and what contributions you might want to make, I found myself in a kind of borderlands between American urban history, which to me really was strongly defined by African-American urban history. And then on the other end, immigration history and Latinx history, right? So books that were on my shelf that I looked at and that I felt were kind of looking at me were books like Becoming Mexican American by George Sanchez, but also Making the Second Ghetto by Arnold Hirsch. And so I think that the contributions I wanted to make were really about returning back to the central city, even in the era of the transnational turn, which I think is an exciting turn, of course, but I felt that we still needed to talk a lot about redlining and the legacies of redlining and segregation and lending and the marketplace in urban America. And I felt that that's where I wanted to make my contribution in showing and arguing for the types of value that Mexican immigrants and Mexican Americans were creating, but also the kind of scripts of devaluing these spaces by the federal government, the city, by bankers, lenders, and speculators. So I think that that's kind of where I came in to my work and felt like I could make the biggest impact.
The first chapter of your book is called Crafting Capital. And I think that there's an interesting play on words because you're talking about, I think, not only kind of capital is in terms of money and the ways that this generation of Mexican Americans are trying to, you know, labor for money, some in the character or the actual person of Anita Villarreal in terms of real estate. But I think, you know, political capital is also, you know, at stake in this book. And so can you help, for those of us who have yet to read the book and for those of who've read the book, to think about, you know, how a community of immigrants, how they build capital in Chicago during the period you're looking at?
Yeah, definitely. That opening chapter, Crafting Capital, you're right to say that it is a kind of play on words. It's both capital in the sense of money and the building of value or the search for value, and also crafting the capital of a Mexican metropolis in the Midwest. And I explore that through the figure of Anita Villarreal, who, as you mentioned, was a prominent businesswoman, a Midwestern Mexicana who entered the real estate industry and was quite successful. And she was one of many folks who initially sought to think of the state and the federal government and the city as structures that would enable the growth and flourishing of Mexican immigrant communities. You have to keep in mind that in the 1940s and 50s, this is kind of during the era of the Bracero program, but also waves of undocumented migrants that are making homes in Chicago in a time where the immigration regime of the INS and the Cold War period is seeking more exertion and control over their bodies and where they can and cannot live. And so I build off of the work of a lot of tremendous scholars on immigration and urban history, but really then delve deeper into the building of those communities. And I asked myself, in the absence of access to federal funds, in the absence of actual being on the winning side of urban renewal, right? They're on the losing side of urban renewal because they get constantly displaced. I then asked myself, how do they then build value and build, enter a kind of marketplace to exert some kind of moneyed influence, right? Kind of small scale capitalism. And I think that that's where I then followed the kind of merchant small business owners that also asked those questions too in the aftermath of urban renewal displacement. So Anita Villarreal, who is displaced, uses that moment to then seize an opportunity to be the primary vendor and renter to Mexican immigrants and finding sites, buildings, homes where she could make a profit, but also open up white neighborhoods that are in the throes of white flight. And so that's really where that second chapter of Demolition and Deportation sets the groundwork for is for the kind of Mexicanization of the rest of the southwest side of Chicago from the early, you know, late 1950s, early 1960s forward.
Well, one of the things that you do really well in the book is that, you know, you show us that, you know, for people who kind of embrace this, you know, post-war capitalist sensibility with real estate of kind of existing within the racial lines of the city of Chicago, the issue of immigration can take that all away. So here in the second chapter, you know, you talk about these kind of parallel tracks of urban displacement and the, you know, the deportation machine in the same place. And they're kind of, they're operating seemingly apart, but but together, they're really helping to kind of forge survival strategies, resistance strategies. And then there are people who, you know, are kind of succumb to it. So can you help us understand, you know, the state of immigration and deportation in this period of time for people who aren't familiar with how it worked in the urban context, even in the face of programs like the guest worker programs, like the Bracero program?
Definitely. So really in the late 1940s, there's a kind of a battleground between agribusiness on the one hand that wants cheap labor, that is benefiting from the Bracero program because, as other scholars have noted, they're really able to exploit migrant guest workers. And then the other side of that coin is the desire by the Immigration and Naturalization Service to want to seek to control immigration and really what would have been called then unsanctioned migrants that were crossing the border to fill labor needs, not just in the fields, but in urban areas like LA, Chicago, New York, even at the in that early period. By the early 1950s, there's an increase in this desire to seek a lot more authority over following migrant brown bodies into urban spaces. One of the key lessons I learned from reading Natalia Molina's wonderful work on how race is made in America is that she looks at places in Los Angeles like Chavez Ravine and Boyle Heights and other neighborhoods that experienced this dual kind of moment of a kind of immigration regime of mass deportation and the concentration of Mexican communities through urban renewal, through long legacies of segregation. And as I explored the communities that I was looking at in Chicago, I realized, these twin projects of demolition through urban renewal and deportation through programs like Operation Wetback from 1954 were happening in the very same urban spaces at the same time. So I wanted to historicize that moment, which is not one year, not just 1954, but really the 1950s and early 1960s, in which the Near West Side, which is the community just west of the downtown loop, where the largest Mexican immigrant and Mexican American community in Chicago existed at the time, as they navigated these twin projects. Now, in the 1950s, mass deportation sweeps like Operation Wetback were, of course, terrorizing the community. The community understood that they were being targeted and they feared for the division of their families and relatives getting deported. But and urban renewal was the jury was still out on what that meant. And so I try to show in chapter two the attempts by the Mexican community to actually engage city planners and city officials to help plan the future of the Near West Side, imagining that they would be part of that future, never thinking that they would be displaced and that in its place would be the building of a new university that would actually displace them and a lot of other people, right? And so Anita Villarreal was somebody that in the 1950s was highly respected in the community. Her background in real estate made her the perfect candidate to be the spokesperson for the community. And so she talked to city planners. In fact, met Mayor Daley in the late 1950s and imagined what this community might look like. The visions were utopian. There was a modern housing, perhaps even a Mexican plaza that would build storefronts for Mexican businesses. But of course, none of that happened. They were displaced, Anita as well. And so I tried to kind of close that chapter with this moment of extreme dispossession by the immigration regime and by urban renewal, and the community having to then rethink their relationship to the city of Chicago for the rest of the 20th century.
So much of urban history, I think, especially, you know, historically, but I think most recently, has found a wider audience because of its engagement about the housing market. And I think that, you know, since the publication of Ta-Nehisi Coates's The Case for Reparations, as well as The Color of Law, there's been a real kind of general and very broad understanding of the federal policies that maintained segregation and promoted the suburbs. And in your book, you talk about the making of the, you know, bungalow belt, the brown bungalow belt, and the ways that not just property ownership broadly, but home ownership and the establishment of Mexican enclaves around the city was also part of a strategy of trying to negotiate power. When we think about Chicago, you know, specifically, and the ways that residential segregation helped reinforce community, what are some of the, you know, insights that you found in terms of looking at how people made decisions about housing and establishing neighborhood power, especially in a city where your neighborhood is sometimes your whole world in terms of access to the political structure?
That's a terrific question, and I hope I can answer it. But I think that when we think of the mid-century years in Chicago, you know, we think about segregation and really a black and white Chicago that is unchanging, that is static. And what I tried to show in this chapter on the making of the brown bungalow belt was that Mexican Americans, in search of housing opportunities, had to negotiate this larger relationship with kind of Northern Jim Crow, which really contained and confined Black Americans. And so I use the phrase unstable vacancies because white residents of working class Chicago, the Southwest Side, you know, South Lawndale, the back of the yards, you know, McKinley Park, these neighborhoods still had a lot of white residents. Residents that organized meetings and expressed a lot of anxiety about fears around the second great migration of African Americans in search of housing, who had for years been contained on the South Side and on the West Side. This was an opportunity as well for folks like Anita Villarreal to enter into this space. And while she was not somebody that would have said anything pejorative against any other ethnic or racial group, what I tried to show is that there's a level of anti-Blackness happening within the meetings that white residents and city organizations of white homeowners are having. And that Mexicans use that opportunity, in particular leaders in the real estate industry, to make a case for themselves, to be those that folks that fill the kind of vacancies of white flight. And so it's a really tricky process that was happening. But let me just give you an example. At the time that South Lawndale is fearing the perhaps the expansion of North Lawndale and Black housing seekers that are trying to look for good livable homes, the leadership of South Lawndale, which was predominantly Eastern European descended, wants to disassociate itself from North Lawndale. And so it changes its name to Little Village, a way to evoke the kind of imaginations of being in, you know, in Bohemia, in the Czech Republic, really to try to kind of change the script of condemnation that is happening in Southwest Side Chicago. This is also the moment that Anita Villarreal moves to Little Village and tries to use a slightly modified script to then sell homes to Mexican immigrants coming from Guanajuato, from Jalisco, from Michoacán, and arguing that white folks are leaving and these homes are beautiful. You can live in these brick bungalows and I will sell you one of these brick bungalows. And eventually 26th Street will be a Mexican corridor. Why? Because I just sold somebody a shoe store, a supermercado, a taqueria. She was a charismatic figure and somebody that would have done very well pitching this story to Mexican immigrants. And in that way, block by block, neighborhood by neighborhood, Mexican immigrants were browning the bungalow belt much more than African Americans were able to during these years.
And as, you know, the neighborhood is starting to become, you know, the neighborhoods that will become Little Village and Pilsen emerge as the representative ethnic neighborhoods of Chicago for Mexicans and Mexican Americans, which is interesting because I think that if you ask, you know, native Chicagoans, even like myself, they imagine Pilsen as having longer roots than it actually does. And so in many ways, Pilsen becomes a product of this particular time and its proximity to the University of Illinois at Chicago, which is expanding its reach, is a really important part of the story. And you talk about, you know, urban renewal, which many of us are familiar with in terms of slum clearance, a kind of gradual shift in public housing, which would lead to the demolition of a lot of public housing in the 1970s and 80s. You know, urban renewal often is about the kind of movement of people and displacement, but you remind us that urban renewal is also about the imagination. And like you said earlier, this idea, utopian visions of how people are going to live in the future and enjoy their communities. And so how did kind of the political organizing of the moment kind of bump up against some of the ideas of what Chicago and particularly the University of Illinois in Chicago will look like for the future in this period of time?
Yeah, no, you know, urban renewal left a bad taste in a lot of communities in Chicago in the post, let's say 1964, 1965 years. And so when we think of the Southwest Side, we think of a neighborhood like Pilsen, you know, I remind readers in the book that Pilsen still had a lot of long-time white residents in Pilsen, in South Lawndale in the 1950s and 60s. In the 1960s, white residents resisted urban renewal, because they saw that it would displace them, as it had folks in the Near West Side. Pilsen wasn't the only community that argued against urban renewal. The Back of the Yards also did not want urban renewal. But they also were ambivalent about having diversity in their neighborhood. So I show how that last wave of white residents in Pilsen, not all of them, but many of them, protested the arrival of Mexican immigrants who were purchasing homes, and so, you know, white residents used long-standing techniques such as rezoning, such as agreements that were cleared through local churches as to who can buy in the neighborhood. What I show is that by the 1970s in the Near West Side, as the community is devastated and dispossessed, and the structures of the University of Illinois Chicago are being built, and there's already students that have matriculated, and we've already got a concrete university in the Near West Side, that the remaining residents, the Black and Brown residents of the Near West Side, ask themselves, what kind of neighbor is this university going to be? They turn to the university leadership to really hold the university accountable and to make sure that the university doesn't expand and continue its displacement legacy. And so they push students and administrators to be reflectful and mindful of the communities that it lives in. In most cases, the university leadership responded with some gestures to creating diverse efforts to matriculate local Black and Brown students, although not enough, of course, in that period. One of the episodes that I cover in the book is this moment in which Mexican-American community activists create a coalition with urban planning students at the university to help them fight off intrusive city development that will affect the Near West Side and Pilsen, and help them create counter plans that would go against a master plan, right? How do we create a kind of advocacy planning that will stabilize the Near West Side and Pilsen for working class people? And this is an effort that was built by organizations like Pilsen Neighbors and the Pilsen Housing and Business Alliance. And these are fights that happened in the 1970s, where the word redlining really comes back into the discourse, and young student planners that are at the university really become allies and help the community collaborate to try to stop the intrusive redevelopment. Because at this point, while urban renewal is unpopular, Chicago as a city and as a government turns to kind of private investors and a kind of market analysis approach to looking at ways that they can create a kind of super loop, a giant tax producing real estate that would surround the loop area. This would include Pilsen, and really make it profitable in the era of white flight. And so Pilsen residents, along with other communities, mobilize to try to stop this, and actually are victorious for a moment in doing this, and then building this kind of coalition with students from UIC.
One of the things that you highlight in your book is the ways that kind of the storied institutions of Chicago, particularly Hull House, are kind of reimagined and pushed by a growing radicalism among Mexican youth. And this may not be fair, because it's like, this is bringing all of your urban history knowledge together, but you know, you talk about it briefly, but in what ways, you know, was the kind of rise in a kind of, you know, radical activism in Chicago, how much of that do you think was about the Chicano movement on the West Coast, as well as the ways that Puerto Ricans were mobilizing in New York as well as Chicago, and the influence of kind of the multiracial and multicultural organizing of groups like the Rainbow Coalition. You know, if you were to talk about the influences of the generation that's taking over Hull's House, that's pushing against UIC, where do you think their kind of political ideology was coming from?
Yeah, so, you know, in the 1960s and early 1970s, I think that you're right. There is a kind of galvanizing period in which there is a lot of cross-racial, cross-ethnic mobilizing that is radical, that is progressive, and that is militant. And I kind of located in a few legacies. One is, of course, the Chicano movement influence. By that, I mean that Mexican-American youth from Chicago, many of them actually paid close attention to what was happening in places like Los Angeles and Denver and El Paso, and the kind of just momentum built behind the fight for self-determination and the cultural nationalism of the Chicano movement. Mexican Americans went to Denver to learn from the conference that Corky Gonzalez, the Chicano leader, held through the Crusade for Justice, and they returned back to Chicago feeling a sense of pride, but also a sense that they needed to turn the local community assets into Chicano liberated spaces. And so they take over settlement houses in Pilsen, and they turned the Bethlehem Community Center into Casa Aslan. So relocating Aslan out of what we think of as Aslan in the Southwest and placing it right smack in the middle of a neighborhood in Chicago, right? Another influence, of course, was a lot of kind of third world decolonization movements around the world. The Cuban Revolution was very influential, as was student movements, the anti-war movement, of course, which Chicago becomes a critical chapter in that movement. There's a lot of coalition building with Puerto Ricans. Mexican Americans are members of the Young Lords in the Near North Side. The Young Lords are very influential and of course collaborate with the Brown Berets and the Black Panthers. They all are fully aware and know Fred Hampton. And so that those are some strains of the kind of radicalism that happened. And another, I would add a third one, which is the community control movement. This idea that the community ought to be exerting control over schools and businesses and just being one community voice against anybody that tried to bully it or displace it in any particular way. And so Pilsen becomes, along with other communities, Lincoln Park and others, part of this wave of community control against displacement and against the political machine. One of the kind of nuances of the book itself is to show residents in the communities that fought the machine, but also residents in the communities that were in favor of the machine. And the people that would be in favor of the machine were folks that had a lot to lose were they to be known to oppose the machine, right? People that had businesses along 18th Street or 26th Street. To have a business meant you had to have business permits or liquor licenses, things that were in the control of City Hall, controlled by the Democratic Party, controlled by Daley's Democratic Party. And so you had to be cognizant of those optics. The machine understood Mexicans quite well, and they, you know, Daley visited the barrios of Mexican Chicago. Anita Villarreal was often a person that Mayor Daley would want to take a picture with. And when I write about that in the book, It's not to say that this is building political power, but that the optics allowed people like Anita and other members of the Mexican Chamber of Commerce to build their clout, their personal clout in the neighborhood. The machine would have been very worried about anybody trying to build kind of electoral power within Mexican Chicago. And that's where the kind of the more militant, progressive, and radical groups come in. They actually try, some reject electoral politics altogether, but others actually try to build electoral power. But it doesn't mature really until the 1980s in the era of Harold Washington.
And that's kind of, you know, that's the last part of the story that I'm really curious to hear your thoughts on. You know, the book ends in some really, you know, kind of key moments. And in some ways, you know, you are kind of alerting us to what's going to, the turn that's going to happen in Chicago politics. And the two kind of notes that you leave on that I think are really important is one, thinking about our concerns about gentrification as not simply being about real estate and high-end luxury stores, that universities are implicated, but also this conceptualization of the artist community. And you talk about, you know, the tensions of creating space within Pilsen for white artists to kind of enjoy the benefits of the neighborhood, and this tension of, well, maybe this is who the neighborhood should be for. So there's that. And then the second are the, you know, uneasy alliances that emerge when there is a Black mayor. And in some ways, I think, you know, foreshadowing some of the political battles that are happening now with demographic shift in Chicago. So can you talk to us a little bit about, you know, what your book can help us better understand about the ways we think of gentrification in Chicago today, as well as, you know, the kind of racial landscape of politics?
Thank you for that. When I write about gentrification in this book, I'm really writing about a word that is sometimes not even utilized by the community. In the 1970s and 1980s, residents in Pilsen, Mexican Americans and Mexican immigrants, were dealing with a serious economic downturn in their communities, plant closures, deindustrialization, job loss, inability to enter the service sector of Chicago in ways that, while we think of the service sector now as something that might be exploitative and have negative connotations, and of course it is those things, many of the service sector jobs were civil service jobs in Chicago in this period, and it was hard for a Mexican immigrant to get a job like that. And so Pilsen and South Lawndale, Little Village, was undergoing a lot of kind of economic woes. And the city itself turned to its bankers and its capitalists to create market studies of these neighborhoods. Literally, they were called market studies or market analysis. And they were created by the Department of Urban Renewal and the Chicago Real Estate Board to think of ways that they can create kind of a type of redevelopment that was funded primarily through private efforts that would create kind of tax-rich land. This would have meant, of course, displacing a lot of Mexican immigrants and Mexican Americans on the southwest side of Chicago. And so, of course, residents were concerned about this. Activists learned about these market studies, and people reacted kind of differently. And so I show the efforts by folks like Anita Villarreal, who would have argued that we shouldn't be displaced, but we should make this place a kind of branded experience for outsiders that want to come to Little Village and eat an authentic Mexican meal and take a stroll down 26th Street and feel like they're actually in Mexico and that they are being tourists in their own city, but not having to leave the city. Other people, like people in the Pilsen Housing and Business Alliance, would have argued that any kind of branding in this particular way will lead to their displacement and will actually increase the value of the real estate in ways that residents will no longer be able to afford the properties there. So there were a lot of kind of dynamic and rich debates around gentrification. At the same time, members of the Department of Urban Renewal, and I show this in the book, learn and take from this data and start buying cheap buildings and trying to recruit artists and other people that will come to Pilsen and live there. One of those folks was John Podmajerski, an infamous figure in the history of Pilsen, who bought hundreds and hundreds of buildings in Pilsen, and cheaply, of course, sometimes using city funds and funding avenues that were meant for working class people, and trying to bring in white artists and other folks, white collar professionals, to live in Pilsen and remake Pilsen in his image. He wasn't the only one, but he was the most vocal one, who often made racist and xenophobic comments in the press about Mexican immigrants and about their alleged inability to fix up their buildings. And in this moment, a group like Pilsen Neighbors became much more militant and much more adamant to raise the volume on people like Podmajerski. They also organized protests against the local savings and loans banks to protest the redlining that they were contributing to, that in the aftermath of the Community Reinvestment Act of 1977 was actually illegal. You, as a bank, you had to open lending to the community that you operated in, which of course your brilliant book Franchise speaks to as well. And so I tried to show the kind of fights within the barrio, but also with speculators and with folks that are gentrifying the neighborhood, to fight off folks that are buying and flipping these properties. And so the final chapter is called Flipping Colonias, because what I'm showing is that there's an attempt by folks like Podmajerski to flip Pilsen into that white collar professional and white creative class population. And at the same time, there's the larger kind of bungalow belt that is being flipped by Mexican immigrants who are changing the face of Gage Park, Archer Heights, McKinley Park. And in that respect, the Harold Washington moment is really, really pivotal, because when Washington campaigned in these neighborhoods, to his credit, he understood that he had to talk not only to the arriving Mexican immigrants that were moving into these neighborhoods, but also the kind of fearful older white residents who were concerned about the diversity in their neighborhoods. And Washington had a knack for, like Anita, to appease and make sure that he tried to show that he cared about the working class, and that he would try to bring new city resources to these neighborhoods. Even then, though, while we talk about a kind of racial coalition in the Washington moment, I also try to show that many Mexican Americans were ambivalent on Washington. And because of the long history and connection to Daley, they actually overwhelmingly, and I'm not the only historian that says this, but there's a few of us out there, overwhelmingly supported Rich Daley in that candidacy in 1983 in the primary. And so what does that mean for Latinx politics in this moment? Well, it shows that there was an element of kind of anti-Blackness within the community, that somebody like Washington was an unfamiliar figure, but also somebody that was suspect to Mexican Chicago. Now, of course, there were exceptions. The great Rudy Lozano was part of the Washington campaign and helped build that coalition. But folks like Anita Villarreal tried to stop that coalition. And so I show that history as well. She tries to run against Chuy Garcia in the mid-1980s because she sees Chuy as somebody that is with Washington, and he was. And she tries to kind of maintain that coalition with the machine and hold the kind of the relationship that the Mexican Chamber of Commerce has with old Daley politics. And it's a nuanced history. I think it's a surprising history, and I hope that folks here will give it a read and let me know their thoughts on the strange politics of the Southwest side of Chicago in the era of Harold Washington.
Well, if that is not enough of an enticement to get a copy of Mike's book, I don't know what is. Mike, thank you so much for helping walk us through the ideas as well as the process. I now invite folks to use the Q&A function in the webinar to ask Mike questions about making Mexican Chicago. And once those questions come up, I will ask them. In the meantime, John, do you have any questions?
Actually, I'm not sure if it's a question, but a little bit of a challenge to Mike that I suspect he's up to. As everybody just heard, the strength of this book is its recognition of human complexity, that it is, you know, it's not a simple story of anything. It's not a simple story of, you know, exploitation or rejection or displacement or of triumph, right? Et cetera, et cetera. It is enormously complex, and the complexities change over time. I guess what I'd like to say, one of the challenges in the midst of getting the complexity right, which I am certain you did, is, can you step back a little bit and offer us your thoughts on, shall I say, the balance of the complexity? To what extent did Mexican Chicago, as it emerged during the period you looked at it, you know, find a sense of self, a series of gains, a sense of belonging? Was it sort of united in the community? Better for some than others. I'd just love to hear your sort of your balance sheet on all this complexity.
Thanks, John, for that hard question. But yeah, I think it is a good question. And, you know, what I've learned in the process of researching and writing the book, and of course, reading terrific urban histories, Latinx histories, of the United States, is that I think what I take away from my own book is that the different generations of Mexican immigration and community building in Chicago did create a refuge for a Mexican metropolis in the Midwest in ways that could be legible and recognizable to Mexican immigrants in Michoacán and in Guanajuato, in San Luis Potosí, people that in a Mexican pueblo understand, hey, I have a cousin in Chicago, I'm gonna make my way out there because I hear that there's work and there's jobs. And in that sense, Mexican immigrants turned it into a Mecca. They turned it into a refuge, a place that could be a home to subsequent immigrants. But in another sense, I think that one of the big lessons for me was that capitalism, it's a hell of a process, but it's definitely something that is hard to beat. And so while many dimensions of the Mexican community try to play the game of capitalism, they try to build wealth and inscribe value into the barrio through the creation of the Mexican Chamber of Commerce, through, as I show, relationships not only with Mayor Daley but with presidents of Mexico to build that clout, that the moneyed interest in downtown Chicago, the moneyed interests of the multinational corporations could create the kind of blueprints for new redevelopment that had no visions and had no imaginations for working people from Mexico in those plans. Yeah. And I think that part of the long process that we're seeing now, and that the roots of it are found in my book, is that Pilsen is being remade into a different community now. And it is sad to see. And you walk through Pilsen today and you do get a sense that it is a Mexican barrio in ways that you see that in Boyle Heights or in parts of Denver. But at the same time, you see the expansion of a different type of Pilsen that imagines itself not as a Mexican community, but creates a new fictive history, a history of a Pilsen that is more imagined through the lens of the 19th century and through a kind of romanticized vision of Pilsen as once a place for German immigrants, for Irish immigrants, for Czech immigrants, Polish immigrants, and filtered through the kind of gentrified bars and coffee shops and restaurants. And so, I think that there's a lot there, but my sense is that money and capitalism is powerful, and it could really erase long, decades-long waves of Mexican immigration.
You don't have to convince me of that last point. But what I will say, too, is the strength you show for the period from post-war into the 80s is itself meaningful and real. And if I might read a little bit on top of your answer today, is that, no, they couldn't make utopia, but they created a locally powerful Mexican-American entrepreneurial class. And with them, they created viable community lives. Not perfect, right? But viable lives for a lot of people struggling to just get by. And arguably, that's an achievement. And right now, you are rightfully exhausted, but your epilogue there sort of says, wow, and there's another book there, Mike, if you ever get the energy to come back and take us through the next stage. But right now, you deserve an exhale. I want to quickly comment, by the way, and you know, and a few others do, that I had the joy of reading the book in manuscript a while back. And truth to tell, I have not yet then gone back through and read it all in its final text. And today you reminded me of Ms. Villarreal. And that, in fact, resonates with some stuff not only have I been doing recently about Mexico, but in precisely those regions that you mentioned so many of these Chicagoans are from, and that we have missed the emergent and enduring power of entrepreneurial women. And they were there. They're not that unique. They're part of the story. And this presumption of, you know, patriarchy, machismo, et cetera, and it all needs to be looked at. But there's another story to the really active, energetic women in here. At that point, I'm going to again encourage our larger community. We want your questions. We're looking for them. And while please type them in, I'd love to hear your thoughts, because this just takes us, right? A week ago, and you know the work, if you couldn't make the session, with George Sanchez. I'd love to hear your thoughts on how Mexican Chicago, which sort of rose on a later and obvious time scale in a different geographical environment, how do you reflect that it is in ways like and in ways unlike sort of the Los Angeles, which is sort of our normative vision, whether it should be or not? Maybe George made it that. but I'd love your thoughts on the latter.
I'm familiar with George's great work on Boyle Heights. And I think, you know, just to not make this too long of an answer, ways that make it familiar with my book and Mexican Chicago is really, you know, the experience with a demographic change of communities and grappling with forms of disinvestment. You've got in Boyle Heights, when, you know, I, as an Angeleno, I'm quite familiar with Boyle Heights. You've got that's the center of the freeways where they all meet, and you see all this concrete that is spatially located in Boyle Heights. Mexican Chicago experienced something similar with the building of the Congress Expressway, as well as the Dan Ryan. So you've got these highways that divide communities, that build that further disinvestment or a kind of predatory investment. In other ways, it's very different. In George's book, you see Mexican immigrants building community in the aftermath of Jewish immigrants and Jewish Americans who were already progressive and liberal. And actually, while George would probably say there was a lot of nuance in the kind of relationships that Jewish people had with Mexicans, there was also a lot of affinity for one another and a kind of handing over of kind of progressive politics in a multiracial democracy or multi-ethnic democracy. You don't see that in Chicago because the communities that Mexican immigrants are entering into, you've got Southern and Eastern European descended white Americans who for the most part become members of the silent majority. These are folks who are going to leave the Democratic Party because of the increasing demographic change in Chicago. These are folks who resist the civil rights movement. They throw bricks and bats at Dr. Martin Luther King. And so Mexican immigrants have to inhabit and make do and find refuge in spaces with very hostile racial and ethnic politics. And I think that that's what makes this book quite different from George's book.
And really says that we, you know, I've been known to say perhaps too often, the macro processes are beyond national, they're global, but everything works out in really distinct local ways. And to really understand it, you've got to get it all together. I'm gonna just note, because it actually doesn't show up so much in the Boyle Heights project, but when a decade ago we drew George Sanchez into the New World Cities project that the Americas Forum published, what he chose to focus on was not Boyle Heights, but the use of redlining and residential segregation to maintain white power in LA. And, you know, when otherwise everything legal was working against segregation, right? All the formal law was trying to take it down. He details how the real estate industry and its support of the county council, et cetera, used it. And I'll just bring that back and to say, it's another, I think, parallel, but that will have worked out in meaningfully different ways in the two. But what I hope people will see is there's just so much to engage here. And these are conversations worth continuing and pursuing. And at this point, I'm gonna pass the mic back to Marcia. We have a question. And before she reads it, I'm just going to encourage more.
So someone was curious about your research and writing process, which I know was lengthy and required you to really go deep in a lot of Chicago archives. Can you tell us a little bit more about that process?
Certainly. I, believe it or not, traveled the entire country far and wide, from the West Coast to the East Coast and everywhere in between, in search of Mexican Chicago. And I found it. I found it in the Stanford archives. I found it at the University of Texas at Austin because of the Alinsky papers. I found it in Columbia University because of Operation Wetback and the commissioner's oral history. And what I learned is that, you know, when you're writing a history of a city like Chicago, it of course transcends its own municipal and county boundaries, and you have to try to find archival records beyond what the city can offer. In the city itself, I was lucky to come across a lot of terrific collections at a lot of great places in Chicago. Chicago is a city that is quite cognizant of its own history and does really well to collect community histories. But I think that as far as Latinx communities go, the city and its institutions can do a lot better. And I think that one of the processes that I experienced was that there were limitations to what the archive can offer me. And so I, one of the reasons this took so long to write is I had to build relationships with community members and neighborhoods in Chicago so that I can learn more about merchants and small business owners, about political leaders and neighborhood leaders. Much of the story of Harold Washington as he knocked on doors in the back of the yards, which was very dangerous for a Black man to do at the time, because the back of the yards was a predominantly white and hostile neighborhood. In that process, I met Mexican-American residents who remembered that moment, who remembered Washington campaigning in their neighborhoods. I learned about people that worked for Mayor Daley, and things I would never have learned from the Daily papers is that, and only through building relationships with community members, is that Mayor Daley created an office for the amigos for Daley on the fifth floor of City Hall in a small closet. And so, you know, building these relationships allowed me to conduct oral histories, scan important materials that I could then use as resources for the narrative, and I think tell a much more comprehensive history of Mexican Chicago that probably was not really possible 10 or even 20 years ago. And in that way, I feel really fortunate to have been able to do that. And I really look forward to the new generation of Latinx Midwestern historians that are gonna update our knowledge of greater Chicagoland, just a greater urban Midwest, because I think that there's a lot more collection and initiatives going on now that will really help us tell much more stronger and dynamic stories of Latinx Chicago and the Midwest.
There's another question that comes in that I think gets to this idea of those transnational ties or links that you mentioned earlier in your presentation. And it was this idea of a kind of political ideology that's informed by something other than one's status as an immigrant or necessarily Chicago's political machine. Is there any way of tracing region identity experience in Mexico prior to the migration to the ways in which people engage in Chicago politics? If someone supported patronage politics in Mexico, were they more likely to do so in Chicago as well?
That's a really good question. And I think a very difficult one to answer because It was nothing in the research that I conducted really allowed me to make quite a claim like that about that kind of support, let's say, for a particular party in Mexico, the PRI or the PAN, and therefore that support in Chicago for the machine or for the Republicans or the Democrats. But I do think that regional identity has been and continues to be incredibly important to Mexican Chicagoans. We see it, of course, in the businesses that are alive and well in Mexican Chicago, from the places that are named after Michoacán or El Bajío or Querétaro or San Luis Potosí. We see it in the hometown associations. Here I think of the great work of Xochitl Bada, who has done some terrific work on the hometown associations and the kind of transnational political activism of Mexican Chicagoans when building infrastructure in their hometowns in Mexico, but also giving them a vehicle and a voice for political action in Chicago itself. I think in my book, where you find the regional identity becoming quite important is in figures like Bernardo Cárdenas. He was a very successful businessman in Mexican Chicago. He owned several restaurants, several furniture stores, and he was a major distributor of chiles from Mexico. That would then redistribute them in the Midwest. Bernardo was an undocumented immigrant. He loved talking about his undocumented status, and he was a political ally of Mayor Daley. He wrote a jingle for Mayor Daley during his election campaigns, took photos with Mayor Daley with his own sombrero and Mayor Daley wearing a sombrero. He was somebody that, along with many other Mexican immigrants, expressed fervent political activity, even though he wasn't able to ever vote for Mayor Daley. And not only that, here, just to throw a wrinkle into his story, he was recruited by the Republican Party to be a kind of foot soldier on the ground for Richard Nixon's campaign in 1968, of which he willingly participated in because he was a businessman. So he chose to support folks that would have helped kind of amplify his business. And again, he was a non-voting political actor in Mexican Chicago of great consequence. And so I think those are the figures that I think I try to highlight that had a kind of regional identity as people from Michoacán, from Guanajuato, from Jalisco, but that also really opened new ways to be political in Mexican Chicago.
I'd love to, if I could hop in just a little. I think you're absolutely right. There's no way, and probably not a lot of importance, whether somebody had identified with one party or another or one thread within it. But I think almost what you described is so many of these people came from a time and places where machine politics in general was the way of life. Voting wasn't what mattered in Mexico. There were certain rituals, but it was knowing how to deal in a world of machines. And in a much more generic way, it may have helped prepare Mexican migrants and perhaps even more the recent, the undocumented. A couple of generations in the US and you might have started to have electoral expectations about how politics would work. If you're fresh out of Mexico, you would know in the 60s, 70s and 80s that if you couldn't get the ear of the machine, you weren't going anywhere. And I'm not sure how that can be studied anymore, but I think there's a real reflection of that in what you described. And I think there's something there.
Well, it seems like our audience is starting to get to dinner and wine and cable news. So I think with that, you know, excellent reflection about, you know, the importance of archives, the importance of contribution, I just want to thank everyone for joining this conversation to not only learn more about, but to celebrate a fantastic book, Making Mexican Chicago by Mike Amezcua. Thank you, everyone.
Yeah, and I'm going to jump in and do just a quick ad for the future here. So we got a couple of weeks break, and then on April 20th, we will look at generations of migration through the two generations of the Jimenez family, father and son, father who crossed undocumented to rise, and then son who is a distinguished scholar. And then the 25th, we will engage with Marta Guerrero and her experiences as a journalist with undocumented delivery workers and house cleaners in New York, and a session we call Carrying New York City Through COVID. So I just want to promote and invite you to all that will be coming soon in this series. And again, thank Mike, thank Marcia, thank Marcella Harden and Carolina Marin, who put all this together in the background, and all of you who joined us today. Thank you all.